Giroux.
Yeah.
Hey,
how
are you?
Hey,
how's it going? Stop this right now. Yeah. Yeah. What you wanted us to be. Come on, baby. Huh? All this action, huh? You're on TV.
Cool place.
I don't know what this is.
Is this okay? Did you want to...
Yeah.
Hello there. This is Julian Casablancas, and I'm here today with a very special guest, Dr. Henry Giroux, just noted intellectual, writer, political, next-level mind. What am I missing? I don't know the generic introduction credentials, but just a special, one of the best minds of today. And just an honor to sit with you and ask you a bunch of random questions. Teach the children to sing.
Yeah, no, I'm honored. I think the combination of music and politics is like poetry.
What entities are more powerful, do you think, banks or nations?
Oh, I think that nations are now controlled by moneyed and financial interests. I mean, I think that the hedge funds, the banks, clearly control the American government. When you look at the number of lobbyists that now are allotted to every person who is in the American Congress, you know, it's just overwhelming. Policies are written basically for corporations. I mean, I think that the notion of the state, the notion of governance being something that's representative of the people is not just simply a lie, not just simply a myth, it's a distortion. It's a complete misrepresentation. And I'll give you an example. Princeton did a study a few years ago in which they looked at policies over a 30 or 40 year period. Mm. 95%, I think, of those policies had nothing to do with the American people. Nothing. And they concluded, Princeton concluded from that level or that Ivy League tower that we no longer live in a democracy, we live in an oligarchy. Oligarchy meaning a government controlled by the rich.
The head honcho in Venezuela says that America is presently trying to incite a coup and overthrow its government, and as America's done in the past in South America many times, by supporting and funding opposition to the government while sabotaging the economy. Is any of that true in your opinion?
No, absolutely. I mean, the United States has a long history of sabotaging any government that basically is not going to support free market principles or support casino capitalism. I mean, the American government's concern with other countries is not whether they're becoming more democratic. The real concern is whether they're becoming more friendly to American business interest. And I think there's a long history from Allende in Chile, of course, to the attempt to assassinate Castro, to the fact that, you know, many American policymakers, and we're not talking about America, the American people, we're talking about American policymakers who really believe that democracy comes at the end of a gun. The mainstream media.
What they need, like a company.
It serves powerful interests and hides behind the notion of being objective and fair. It's like Fox News saying, what is it? We give you the news that's fair, you know? And it's like a joke, right? Mm. I mean...
Well, you're allowed to lie.
Yeah, I mean, remember, the media is controlled by 95% of the media is controlled by six corporations. How could you possibly, in the midst of that kind of control, expect fairness?
The connection between, like, that sentence, it doesn't, like, people don't know what to do with it. You know what I mean? Like, they hear six companies control all the media. Okay, you could sit down, you could analyze that, and you obviously can come to the conclusion that, of course, you know, big companies that big that spend that much money on lobbying, they wouldn't just allow their news station to say whatever they want.
No, they won't.
But people don't get that connection from that sentence. They're just like, well, that's, you know, they assume that because companies are competing against each other, they can't, there's not, they're all like, someone's telling the truth or they're competing.
Yeah, I mean, but that's the work of politics, right? The work of politics is to make the corruption of power visible and to argue that you don't have a democracy when six companies control the media.
What do you think of Bill Maher?
I think he adds a political register to comedy that is really instructive, right? Mm. I don't like his Islamophobia. You know, I mean, that's a little hard to take at times, but I like what he does. I mean, I think it's important. I think it's informative. And I think it's helpful. He has his flaws, but overall, I mean, he's a good guy.
Yeah. You know. Would you do his show? Have you?
I don't get invited to these shows. Social provisions are lacking, and people become immiserated in more and more poverty. Jobs move abroad. You live in a new age. You don't live in an age in which the motto is, let's try to get ahead. The motto now is, let's try to survive. This is the age of survival. This is a survivalist age, because what we have now is we have an age of precarity in which nothing is certain anymore. My dad worked in a factory. He had a job. He'd go there every day, and he envisioned that job for 40 years. Most people will have 15, 20 bosses now in their lives. No permanency, no social provisions. Retirement is being wiped out. And as the social contract dies, democracy dies, because it takes all the resources of society and it mobilizes them for the 1%, and everybody else can go to hell. It's a ruthless, ruthless understanding of politics. But I have a question. Is that okay?
Yeah, of course, please.
All right.
Whatever.
I want to tell you why I was so impressed that you came. And then I want to follow that up, if I may, right? Because we've talked about this in the other room, and I want to explore this stuff. I mean, for me, my generation is dying off. There aren't many of us left. And I'm not sure that we would be able to implement any of the kinds of changes that your generation has to implement. So I'm always enormously impressed when I see young artists, when I see people in the cultural realm, when I see your generation all of a sudden, for instance, rejecting homophobia, rejecting racism, talking about the need for a new kind of music, and defining artists as public intellectuals, and trying to figure out how they can use their talents, to in some way make the world a better place. And I guess the question that I struggle with is, what kind of burden is now placed on young people, to be able to address a moment in history in which they find themselves, which is enormously oppressive and doesn't serve their interests, and what does that mean for people in music? And how did you come to be, where did you get your political consciousness from?
I've been fascinated with politics, I guess, vaguely all my life. And I think that it was probably Chris Hedges' video.
Did it for you?
I think that was the first real awakening. And you asked me my generation or younger. I think the burden is that they don't understand the burden. You grow up believing this thing, everything you're saying is the opposite. You grow up thinking, oh, democracy, we solved all those problems. Those are old problems and we fixed it. And frankly, it's hard to face that. It's depressing. It's like, I don't know if you saw The Matrix, but it's like, the blue pill or the red pill. It's like, do you really want to know what's going on? It's kind of like, no, I don't. But now that I know, I can't help it. And the more you see how uninformed people are, yeah, you feel like, actually, that's the struggle, is that whether or not you understand that there is a struggle going on.
Oh, I think that's fabulous. That's essentially a challenge and a definition of politics that is unique to your generation, in my estimation, in that you recognize the educational nature of politics itself, meaning that central to politics is the challenge to be able to inform people, make power visible, and hold power accountable. That means you have to change consciousness. It means you have to work hard to expose the dark elements of authoritarian systems. That means that you have to fight for justice. Capitalism,
how can you make the most of
around
that?
Culture is an assassin, right? It eliminates all that's magical.
Quality.
All that's quality, all that's that pushes the imagination, all that stretches the possibility for real talent. And it gets vanilla music.
It scientifically, right? Extracts the most amount of pennies.
Yes,
possible.
Just as you said earlier. That's why it's so amazing that a band like yours, I mean, can have the following that it has because it pushes against that grain. Even when it's not directly political, it is political because it stretches the imagination. That's political to me. I hate orthodoxy. I hate political purity. You know, I want to see people who are constantly exhibit two things, a sense of self-reflection and a compassion for others. That's the key.
Do you ever, either now or maybe when you started or at any point studying history and seeing all the people kind of taken down who spoke truth to power, ever worry about your safety?
I mean, when you're involved in this work, there's always risk. You know, you don't go into this work wanting to be liked. You don't go into this work thinking you're going to get awards, right? You go in knowing you're going to take a chance. And I've never doubted ever since I've started that I would ever compromise my dignity by living on my knees rather than standing up. Never.
Wow. Well, thank you so much.
Oh, it's a pleasure. You bet.
You're the best, and I don't know how to end these things, so...